A very warm welcome once again to Ashwamedh Elara India Dialogue 2016. Now, after the Simhavlokan, the reform process followed since May 2014, we move on to specifics of the government's agenda. The newfound political stability has built on existing positive structural, and global investors are attracted to the great Indian opportunity. The government's three flagship programs, Digital India, Make in India, and Skill India, constitute the triangle of growth. Our keynote address today by Mr. Jayant Sinha, Honorable Union Minister of State of Finance, titled Growing in a Slowing World, Opportunities and Challenges would do just that. Jayant Sinha is a Lok Sabha Member of Parliament representing the Bharatiya Janata Party from Hazaribagh in Jharkhand. He has served as a member of the Standing Committee on Finance and Public Accounts Committee. Mr. Sinha has more than 25 years of experience as an investor and strategy consultant, and please join me in giving him a warm welcome here on stage. I'd also like to invite on stage Mr. Raj Bhatt and Lord Desai to join the Honourable Minister on the podium. Do we have the remote for Mr. Sinha's presentation?
No, I'll walk. Okay. Do you want me to stand? Yeah?
Good. With that, it's over to the Honorable Minister.
Can I have the clicker for the presentation? And is there a clicker? So yeah. I can move this forward. Ashish? Or should I just say advance the page and you'll advance the page? Is that how you want to do it? All right. Well, thank you very much, and I'm very glad to be with you all this afternoon now that it's past 12 and share with you all some of the work that we've been doing in reforming and transforming the Indian economy. As you know, the slogan that really defined our campaign and really defines in a way our agenda is Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas. And what we are really trying to accomplish is transform India under that rubric. So what I thought I would do is to actually take you through a presentation that lays this out. Being a former consultant, I like PowerPoint and I like frameworks, so you'll please indulge me in that. So I'll go through that and I'll highlight specifically with this particular budget that we just presented in Parliament on February 29, how we try to take forward that agenda. And then I'm happy to take any questions you might have. All right, so why don't we go to the next page? You have that. Excellent. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you a little bit about how the Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas framework has been set up. What is the transformation architecture? What is the framework that we're using to guide our policy making? And then I'll talk a little bit about what we've done as far as this budget is concerned. You do have a copy of this presentation, and you can go through the appendix, but what we've tried to do in the appendix is list all of the achievements that we have done so far as the government is concerned. Now, let's hope this works. It's going the wrong way. All right, let's see. Aha, okay, good, excellent. Now we've got it to work. So just very quickly from a context point of view, the 2014 mandate, as we all recognize, is a historic opportunity for us. It's in fact a profound moment for India. We obviously have an aspirational middle class, a middle class with very high expectations of acche din, of good days. We have a decisive, visionary leader, Sri Narendra Modi ji, who has, and our government has, a rock-solid majority in the Lok Sabha that enables us to undertake policy actions that were much more difficult to do previously when they did not have a rock-solid majority in the Lok Sabha. So it is, in that sense, a very profound moment for India. Now, groups. Okay. What we've been able to do with the mandate that we have received is, in a short period of time, within 18 months, actually transform and bring to India macroeconomic stability. Now, you all know that achieving macroeconomic stability can typically take 2 to 3 years. It doesn't happen that quickly, particularly when you inherit an economy where all the economic indicators, the macroeconomic indicators, were flashing red. So whether it is inflation, current account deficit, fiscal deficit, GDP growth, in all of these parameters, the economy was actually in quite bad shape. But what we've been able to do in 18 months is actually turn the macro around and really achieve macroeconomic stabilization. And all these same parameters that were flashing red are now flashing green. Now, of course, the skepticism, the critics will always say it's because of oil prices. And to an extent, they're right. But what the global economy giveth on the one hand, the global economy takes away on the other hand. So obviously, aggregate demand, global demand has been very soft. Exports have come down quite a bit, which has in fact hurt us. Of course, what we are facing because of global climate change and because of droughts and so on has also been a real challenge for us to deal with. And so we've had to deal with all of the agrarian distress associated with two deficient monsoons, which is the first time it's happened in 30 years, the fourth time in 115 years. So we've had to deal with some good factors externally, but some bad factors externally as well. And of course, as far as inflation is concerned, you all know that we passed through only some of the oil price decline. So the decline in inflation is not necessarily due to the fact that oil prices have come down. It's been done through a series of good policies. As Honorable Prime Minister said, it was not good fortune that turned around the macroeconomy. It was good policy, not good fortune. And so that's what we've achieved. All the numbers are looking good. And certainly as far as the BRIC economies are concerned, everybody's view is now that we are the only one left standing. Now, with the macroeconomic stabilization that we've achieved, we are in a position now to really drive forward, really be able to drive forward with our reform agenda. And what are we trying to accomplish with Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas? What are we really trying to accomplish? There's a strategy and certain core principles that we follow. Now, the strategy is that we want to build India's productive capacity. We want to build India's productive capacity. This is a very clear investment-driven supply-side view of the world. It's a supply-side view of the world because we want to build up India's hard assets, the power plants, the factories, the roads, the bridges, the highways, the ports, all the hard assets. But equally and in some ways more importantly, we want to build India's soft assets as well. Our regulatory institutions, our judicial systems, our innovation ecosystems, our institutions of learning and so on. So we recognize we have to build up the hard assets and the soft assets. Together, when we do that, we build India's productive capacity. We build India's productive capacity, then, and only then, are we able to sustain what we urgently and importantly need, which is sustained high growth for decades. In the past, we've been able to sustain growth, fast growth, for periods of time, 2 years, 3 years, but then we run into the inevitable supply side bottlenecks because the structural reform, all of what's required on the supply side has not happened, and growth comes down dramatically. As you know, famously has been said, you know, the central bank takes away the punch bowl just as the party gets going, right? So we need to make sure that as far as the supply side reforms and the supply side efforts are concerned, we really, really enable those to happen. Now, as we are doing that, what are the core principles that we follow? What are the principles that are of primary importance to us as we think about policy making? We are a pro-poor government. We are a pro-poor government. We believe that the first responsibility of our government, the most important responsibility of our government, is to ensure that we eradicate extreme poverty in India. We eradicate extreme poverty in India. This is not a matter of political necessity. We are doing it because we believe it's our moral responsibility, a moral sacred responsibility to end extreme poverty and destitution in India. And this isn't something that we have whipped up in the last year or two. This is something that, as far as our party is concerned, from the Jan Sangh days onwards, Antyodaya thinking, through the Bharatiya Janata Party into the NDA too, it has been absolutely the primary principle around which our economic policy making has been done. We are a pro-poor government. But because we are a pro-poor government, because, ladies and gentlemen, we are a pro-poor government, we are a pro-markets government. We are a pro-market government. Because unless markets flourish, unless competition flourishes, unless innovations flourish, unless our companies do well, unless they create jobs, unless growth happens, how can we be a pro-poor government? So we are a pro-poor government, but we are also a pro-market government. We are massively pro-poor, but we are massively pro-market. They are two sides of the same coin. There is no contradiction, there is no trade-off. Now, even as we are a pro-poor government, and I'm now coming to the third principle, even as we are a pro-poor government, we are not a populist government. We are not a populist government. We believe in empowerment, not entitlement. Now, obviously, we have to create a basic safety net. I think for all of us, it is extraordinarily important that nobody dies because of hunger. Nobody dies because they couldn't get health care. Nobody dies because they are completely destitute. So we have to create a basic safety net. That in any civilized society, for all of us, I think we are all part of the same humanity, part of the same country, where we have to create a basic safety net. So we establish that basic safety net. That's what we're trying to do with the Food Security Act, with NREGA on a demand basis, and so on. Housing for all. We want to be able to create a basic safety net. But once we've created the basic safety net so that people have a full stomach, people are educated, we then want to create opportunity. It's not about entitlement, it's about empowerment. And what we've done with Jan Dhan, what we've done with Mudra, with what we've done with our policies, is to really focus on the empowerment side. So it's about empowerment, not entitlement. That is a very important principle for us. And as we work on the market side, we want to create a rules-driven, policy-oriented state that is not discretionary. So we want to roll out the red carpet, not the red tape. We want to provide simple, predictable, fair policies, a fair tax regime. And then finally, because we obviously recognize the only way India can progress if the states progress, is we believe in Team India. We believe in cooperative federalism. These are the important principles that guide our policy making. Now, here's the framework that I threatened you with. I threatened you with the framework, but this is basically the way we think about our policy making architecture, our transformation architecture for India. As I said, the overarching theme, the rubric that spans what our initiatives are, is Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas. So we really need to progress everyone. We really need to be able to provide development that lifts people up. Now, as we are doing that, we focus on four important target groups. Number one, as I said, has to be the poor. Garibon ki unnati. And for this, we have a number of different initiatives that are underway. Universal social security, which we think is historic. I'll talk about this a little bit. Housing for all, food security, NREGA, and so on. Obviously, we are doing other things as well, such as the LPG connections. Then we have Kisano ki samriddhi, which is the prosperity of our farmers. And obviously, there's a whole host of things. We've got Pradhan Mantri Sichai Yojana, Fasal Bima Yojana, Soil Health Card, the functioning of various agricultural markets, all of that underway as far as the prosperity of farmers is concerned. Then, and we all recognize India's demographic situation, which of course is something we have to harness if we wanted to really move in the right direction, which is Yuvaon ko Rozgar. We need to create jobs for our youth. And there, Make in India, Skill India, Mudra, Startup India, all of these are designed so that we have sufficient job creation and our young people are not just job seekers but job creators as well. So that's what we're doing as far as युवाओं को रोजगार is concerned. And then finally, for the middle class, the idea is एक बेहतर जिंदगी, a better life, a better quality of life, स्वच्छ भारत अभियान, transportation, better education, environment and climate change. All of these initiatives are there to improve quality of life for you all living in the big cities and in the fast emerging urban areas of India. And so even as we are addressing these target groups, even as we define our policies specifically to benefit these important groups, there are a number of horizontal areas where we have to work which really are about desh ki pragati, desh ki udan, which is really for the development of the entire country, building infrastructure through public investments, the robust financial system, transparent and predictable tax regime, and all the things that we have underway for cooperative federalism. So those are the underlying cross-cutting initiatives that help us drive these other things that we have underway. Now, I'll conclude here, and then hopefully we can get into a more interactive session. But let me talk a little bit about this most recent budget. Now, as you all know, budgets are meant to be balanced. Otherwise, Swami will really take us to task. So we have to balance our budgets. All budgets have to be balanced. The question is how? How do you actually achieve that balance? And I think what most people have appreciated in the most recent budget is that we have indeed been able to strike a fine balance. A fine balance between India's modernized, globalized 21st century economy, which is what you all represent, and India's informal, rural, poor, remote economy, which I represent, coming as I do from Hazaribagh in Jharkhand. So we had to strike that balance between the formal economy and the informal economy, between India on the one hand and Bharat on the other hand. So that's one balance we've struck. The other balance we've had to strike is between fiscal consolidation and fiscal prudence on the one hand, and then stimulating and boosting growth as much as we can. So that is another balance we've had to strike. And then finally, as all budgets strive to do, is we have to strive to achieve a balance between good economics and good politics. So I think we've achieved that as well in this budget, which is why I think it's been appreciated so far. In the budget itself, even as we've struck this balance, ladies and gentlemen, even as we've struck this balance, there are five or six things that we have done that I genuinely, genuinely believe that you should pay attention to. Because I think they are profoundly transformational as far as India and India's economy is concerned. And I'll start and I'll go through these very quickly. I'll start with Social Security. You must pay attention to what is happening with the build-out of the Social Security platform that we have underway. Starting with Jan Dhan. But now with Mudra, with the scholarships that we are putting on, the Narega payments that we are doing, and importantly in this budget, with the 1 lakh rupee health cover that we are providing below poverty line families. Ladies and gentlemen, we are doing something as historic as what President Roosevelt did during the Great Depression in 1935 when he introduced Social Security. This is profoundly, profoundly transformational for India. So that, I think, is extraordinarily important. Then, of course, we are working to rejuvenate the rural economy in terms of rural roads, irrigation, all of that, housing, fiscal consolidation. Of course, we've stuck to our 3.5% fiscal deficit roadmap. We are saying we've got to rethink FRBM, and we are going to work on that. Obviously, we have a whole host of things underway as far as the public sector banks are concerned. I'm just coming from the Bank Board Bureau meeting. We've got that kicked off. We've said we are going to really undertake consolidation. That is happening. We're transforming the tax ecosystem. As far as litigation is concerned, as far as self-certification is concerned, there are a number of steps we've undertaken as far as the tax ecosystem is concerned that is extraordinarily important. And then finally, as you all know, if you look at the kind of money that's pouring into roads, national highways and rural roads, 97,000 crores. If you look at what's going into railways, 1.21 lakh crores, up from 58,000 crores in the last year of the UPA. And you look at what we're doing in irrigation. The combination of these investments in roads, railways, and irrigation, the three perhaps most important sectors as far as public investment is concerned in terms of multiplier effect on the economy, we have really, really opened the spigots and, you know, provided the capital to really drive these areas. So that's why we think the budget has been well received, because there are some very, very important, very profoundly useful and valuable initiatives that we have unleashed as part of that. So I'm going to stop here. Obviously, there's lots more detail about each of these different initiatives. There's a full appendix that talks about all the achievements that we've done so far. I will just conclude with one point. By the way, the presentation is with you all. If you want, I'm sure Elara will give you copies. But there's a lot more. There's a 30, 40, 50-page presentation we've put together. But I'll close with the following. In the hype cycle which we live in, I see many friends of the media here. In the hype cycle and the media cycle we live in, because of the headlines that have to be brought out, you tend to overestimate the short run. Because it's the hype, the headlines, etc. Overestimate the short run. But because there isn't sufficient analysis, there isn't sufficient reflection in this noisy world we live in, we underestimate, ladies and gentlemen, the long run. We underestimate the long run. If you look at the profound structural changes that are now underway in the economy, and I can, you know, get into this in great detail if you want to ask me about the sector after sector, but if you look at the profound changes that are underway in the economy right now, you are underestimating how dramatically we are actually changing the Indian economy. And I'll close with saying the following, that don't miss the forest for the trees. Don't miss the forest for the trees. Because the manner in which we are changing Indian capitalism, we think, is a profound, profound transformation. The manner in which Indian capitalism worked over the last decade in the UPA time, and the manner in which Indian capitalism is working now, is just profoundly different. We think it's a very, very, very welcome change. It's a change that you all will appreciate, and you all will consider as being something that the country urgently and importantly needs. Thank you. Happy to take questions.
Happy Gudi Padwa. You should say Happy Gudi Padwa. Real project.
So with your permission, we'll take a few questions from the audience. So with a raise of hands, there's a gentleman at the back. So please remember to introduce yourself. And also, we'd appreciate if you can keep your questions short and to questions only, not observations.
Okay, good.
Anshul, can you just take that?
Hello, sir. This is Nikunj Doshi from Bay Capital. Just wanted to understand the logic of government in not passing on the oil price benefit to the consumers. Say, had we reduced diesel prices aggressively, it would have helped lowering inflation, and perhaps it would have helped lowering bank rates faster. So what is the rationale of not passing on the oil price benefit to the consumers?
No, obviously, this is a matter that we discussed and debated intensively. And there are really three considerations that tilted the balance to the side of, you know, passing it through only up to a point. And those three considerations were, first, were obviously the fiscal deficit and the ability to be able to bring down the fiscal deficit from the high levels that we inherited it. We inherited it at 4.4%, but it was probably much higher than that because there were a lot of liabilities, to bringing it down to the 3.9% and now the 3.5%. So one was fiscal consolidation, was obviously one aspect. The second aspect was that it gave us the buffer as well to deal with volatility in the oil markets down the road. So in fact, if prices climb back up again very quickly, we can just take the excise tax off and still keep the price roughly where it is, and that enables us to manage inflation and volatility a little bit better as well. And then the third reason also was to make sure that our oil marketing companies which have had to subsidize and deal with significant losses as oil prices had gone up, were able to repair their balance sheets to an extent. So again, in all these kinds of judgment calls, you have to make trade-offs, but that's how we call this trade-off.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Alpana. I'm an infrastructure consultant, but I also deal with education on my social side of initiative. Compliments to the government for an inclusive job, but my observation is that somewhere the budget allocation for education at the very primary level has been compromised in the budget. Do you, the allocations have gone down. If you look at the state of primary education, government or MCD schools across the country, where are we getting over with this kind of a gap if we are talking of Skill India and Make in India and Stand Up India, if this is how the educations are getting cut down? To the extent of 30% to 40%, we have seen lower budgets for education. So I'm unable to
understand. I'd like to correct your perception. You have to understand that Sarva Siksha Abhiyan is mandated by statute. And the education cess, which is collected for Sarva Siksha Abhiyan, goes directly into education. So there's no question there of altering those numbers because it's funded through a cess. So Sarva Siksha Abhiyan is fully protected, just like other cess-based programs are fully protected. And of course, as you look at education, we have made sure that we have funded it appropriately, given the programs that have come to us through the HRD ministry. But you also have to take into account the fact that through the 14th Finance Commission and the devolution that has gone to the states now of 42% of divisible tax revenues, we've had to transfer some of these activities to the states themselves. Does anyone know, prior to this 14th Finance Commission, by the way, the 14th Finance Commission went from 32% devolution to 42% devolution. Does anyone know in the 13 other finance commissions, what was the delta? What was the change in this devolution, as it's called, the vertical devolution? Does anyone know which was the maximum other change prior to this? The answer is 2.5%. So in 13 finance commissions, effectively that means you went from, let's say, 20% to 22.5%. So this particular change of 32 to 42%, the 10% change of revenues going to the states was four times what has ever been done before. So the states have benefited handsomely, and the amount of money that's gone to the states as a result of that has gone up dramatically. But as that has happened, naturally we at the center are constrained in terms of how much we can spend. So if you look at education budgets, it's erroneous, utterly wrong in fact, to just look at the central budget. That's not the way to look at it. You have to look at state by state and look at the general government spending, which is state plus center plus urban local bodies and so on, and then see is education spending going up or going down. Only then can you come to a conclusion. I can assure you it's actually not gone down, it's gone up. And even as far as the center is concerned, as I said, as far as Sarva Siksha Abhiyan is concerned, that's assessed and that's protected. So I would suggest that you should correct your perception.
Do we have another question?
Good afternoon, Susana. My name is Venkat Subramanian. You mentioned, being pro-market is one of the key principles. In a country where millions of people are yet to buy their first motorcycle or white good, the import duty that you have imposed on steel, increasing a critical input cost, is it really pro-market? Is it not better for the consumption side of the economy if input prices are allowed to have the natural course when there is a surplus globally?
Yeah. Would you call the US a pro-market economy?
Of course, all the countries around the world are trying to do that, but India...
Yes or no? Is the US a pro-market economy or not?
Sure, yeah.
Yes?
Yeah.
Do you know how much the US has increased import duties?
Yeah, but for
282%. Do you know why? Because sometimes markets go through certain episodes, certain situations where there are distortions when they are not working very well. Under those circumstances, because ultimately markets don't exist in thin air. Markets exist within a construct. Market exists within a policy-making framework. Markets exist within a set of global economic arrangements. Sometimes those markets work well, sometimes they don't work well. When markets are not working well, then you have given us the responsibility as citizens of India, as the state, to be able to take policy action. So we've taken policy action, and that policy action is consistent with what other market economies have also done.
Sure, but what's more important for us is the consumption side on the lower end of the society, which is perhaps not true for some of the developed countries. So, whose interests
are we? Like a lot of other policy actions, there are trade-offs and there are judgment calls, right? You've given us the task of making those judgment calls right now, and while we are there, for the next 3 years, we'll make those judgment calls. You may agree or disagree with some of those calls, and then you can express yourself in the voting booth when the time comes. But as of now, that's the judgment call we've made.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think we have two questions here.
Yeah, hello. My name is Devnathan from Goldcrest Advisors. Thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. And I have two questions. One is, are you satisfied at the speed at which the PSU bank issue is being resolved, and what time frame do you think that by when it will be fully behind us? And the second question is, Mr. Raghuram Rajan's tenure, I believe, ends in about 4 months. So is the finance ministry inclined to give him an extension?
We are undertaking the most sweeping set of reforms as far as the public sector banks are concerned. We initiated the whole process with Gyan Sangam in January of 2015, and that whole process is underway right now. I would say that it is going through three very important phases. The first phase was governance and management reform. I don't want to go through that in detail, but if you go and you Google Indradhanush, you'll see all the changes that were affected as part of governance and management reform. That was phase one. Phase two was really dealing with the NPA issue and undertaking the stress tests that we've done through the asset quality review in conjunction with the Reserve Bank of India, which is what we've been engaged in over the last 8 or 9 months. So that was the second phase. The third phase is really starting now, which is really the consolidation phase and making sure that our public sector banks are much stronger competitors going forward, given the tectonic changes that are happening in the financial sector landscape. All of these actions that we are undertaking through these different phases, in some, are the most far-reaching and the most sweeping set of reforms for the public sector banks since they were nationalized in 1969. So we feel like we are pushing the reform agenda and our initiatives very, very quickly. And we think this is what's required. Now to your second question, you're asking the wrong person.
Thank you.
We have one. We'll take one last question from the gentleman at the back.
Jeetu Punjabi. Jayant, you know, the LPG subsidy was taken away for people earning over 10 lakhs, which I thought was a great move and I support it fully. In the same tone, wouldn't it be fair to broad-based tax revenues by taxing farmers with greater than 10 lakh income?
You should bring that up as a matter for public debate.
Would you, I mean, what would your opinion be on that? I mean,
let us see how the public debate emerges on that.
Okay, thanks.
I believe you have one more question.
Mr. Sinha, there has been a lot of effort, positive effort from the part of the government on ease of business, on Make in India, Skill India and a lot of that. For the growth to come in, we also probably need to see private sector investment cycle kick in. The capex hasn't really kicked in to the extent it probably should have. Even when these initiatives were probably not there, there appeared to be greater investment happening. There is that effort on the part of the government to be spending a lot, but what do you think is further needed to ensure that the private sector investment cycle also kicks in at the pace that can take growth to 8 to 9%?
Now, there are obviously a variety of factors that come into play when you consider the private investment cycle, and you know them as well as I do. It's a question of over-leveraged balance sheets right now in the private sector, slow export demand, low capacity utilization. All of these factors are there. I think, consumption kicks in through the OROP, through the seventh pay commission, through the lower interest rates and so on. And we are seeing very good signs over the last year that urban consumption has been very strong. We see that in all the indicators. But we really need rural consumption also to pick up, which it will it'll do if we have a good monsoon. Obviously, the agrarian distress that we've had has really impaired rural consumption. But I think once rural and urban consumption pick up, and capacity utilization starts to go up as well, all the other conditions are generally in place for investment. So I'm quite hopeful that we'll see a turn of that cycle relatively soon. I don't think there are any other conditions that are, except for just utilization, that are getting in the way. Because if you look at FDI trends have been very strong. There is a tremendous appetite and interest as far as foreign investors, FDI investors are concerned, in terms of investing in the India growth story. Foreign investment has been very strong, FDI. Private and domestic investment in India, I think once we get capacity utilization to go up and the leverage on the balance sheets to come down, I think we'll pick up as well. So that's at least my sense, but we are seeing that there are many aspects of the economy right now that are already moving forward quite strongly. You all have to recognize that there are still significant sectors of the economy, steel, metals in general, which includes aluminum, iron ore, of course, power, and so on, where there is a real issue of both global factors and circumstances as well as leverage balance sheets. So with those sectors relative to the past having come down sharply, when you look at the aggregate private investment numbers, it looks like it has come down, but it's really a story of different industries and different sectors. You see what I'm saying? Because investment in certain of these sectors, whether it was power or whether it was steel or it was iron ore, coal, etc., was so high in a certain time period, compared to that, private investment looks like it's come down. But that is to be expected given what is happening.
We'll take one more question from the gentleman.
Good afternoon, Mr. Sinha. My name is Suresh Lakshmi Narayanan. The GST saga has kind of elongated for quite a long time. So from, as things stands now, are we seeing light at the end of the tunnel, or would we have to wait probably for an NDA 3?
We are very hopeful that in the second half of the budget session, as Honorable Finance Minister said yesterday as well, that indeed we will be able to get GST passed. All parties are in support of the GST, apart from one party. As long as the Rajya Sabha functions from April 25th to May 13th, and we can table this and have a discussion around it, we are quite hopeful we'll be able to pass the constitutional amendment. The gap between what we are proposing and what the Congress party is demanding has closed very, very decisively down to just one factor. And as you know, they are insisting that the 18% cap be in the constitutional amendment, which we think is really a violation of how India's political economy, how India's governance is set up. And so we don't think that is in the best interests of the country and is consistent with our governance processes and our constitutional democracy. We have a very strong point of view on that, and we think that the national opinion is very much in that favor as well. So that really is the only gap at this stage, as best as I can determine, and therefore overall we are actually quite hopeful that in fact, along with the bankruptcy bill, which also is a profoundly important set of changes that will be undertaken, that GST will also get passed.
On behalf of Elara, I'd like to thank our Honorable Minister for that engaging presentation and joining us here in this interaction today.